A very good afternoon and warm welcome to all delegates who have joined us today on the virtual platform of Day 2 of the Livelihoods India Summit 2021. We will be starting with a technical session on our farmer producer organizations beginning to sustain evidences from the ground. This session is being held under Track 4 discussions on building a sustainable ecosystem for farmers producer organizations. It is my pleasure to invite the esteemed panel for the session, Richa Govil, Azim Premji University, Mr. Yogesh Thorat, MD, Maha FPC, Mr. S.S. Bhatt, CEO, FWW India, and Mr. Shubhendu Dash, Access Development Services. Introducing the session, with the government's 10,000 FPOs program, the number of FPOs registered in the country has doubled over the last 2 years, from 7,000 to nearly 16,000. It has now become more important than ever to look at the ground realities in terms of whether we are just reaching the numbers or whether the FPOs are beginning to sustain. In this session, we hope to discuss the policy environment in which the FPOs operate, identify the current constraints, and look at the opportunities that can be leveraged to help evolve FPOs into viable business entities and build an enabling ecosystem within which the FPOs can flourish. It is now my pleasure to invite Mr. N. Srinivasan, who will be moderating the session from us. Mr. N. Srinivasan is an expert, development finance and rural livelihoods. Mr. Srinivasan had been a central banker and development banker for well over 30 years, following which over the last 10 years as an independent consultant, he has been involved in design, supervision, and evaluation of policy, strategy, and implementation of several development finance and rural livelihood initiatives and for building institutions in India and abroad. He is consultant to premier agencies such as the World Bank, IFAD, GIZ, KfW, NABARD, and SIDBI. And he has also authored the State of India's Livelihoods Report for the years 2015, 16, and 17. Mr. N. Srinivasan, the floor is now yours.
Thank you, Mayuk. Let me welcome all the participants who have logged in to hear about where the FPOs are going, how they are performing, and what is in store for the future. We talk about the sustainability of FPOs. Do we see an emerging trend that more and more FPOs are becoming sustainable? I could not have asked for a better panel from the audience point of view. It's a diverse panel. There is a leading academic and researcher, Dr. Govil. Dr. Bhatt, I don't need to introduce him to the FPO community. They have seen him as the person who brings some money where no one else is willing to give. Even in his earlier avatar in Ananya and the current avatar in FWWB, he has been a close friend of FPOs. We have got a large FPO confederation person who looks after a large network of FPCs in Maharashtra, which is one of the more active states. And of course, Subhendu from a promoting organization who is going to give us some, a map of what's happening out there. So he is all ready with his presentation. In the beginning, I would only like to, lay out. We are going to have, after the first presentation by Subhendu, a series of rounds of questions. I will encourage the audience to send in their questions right from the beginning. So the questions that come, I would prioritize them over any questions that I may have framed or the panel members have in mind. So we would like to be more relevant and responsive to what you have in mind as issue that you would like to, discuss rather than what's our agenda on this. With this, I would ask Subhendu to talk about what he has in store for us. Yes, Subhendu, you are live.
Thank you, Mr. Srinivasan. Just let me share my presentation. A very warm afternoon to all the participants, honorable panelists. So I am Subhendu Das, Program Director, Access Development Services. The topic given is, are the farmer producer organizations beginning to sustain? So I have brought some evidence from the ground. We are working with Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, with support from Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and Department of Agriculture, Farmer and Farmer Welfare, so Odisha. And this is a remote program which we are operating in Nawarangpur, Odisha. So I would like to bring some facts from the ground. So as you can see, yet my next page is, are you not able to see?
We are seeing, yeah. Okay. The major value chain, yes.
I'm not seeing it in the screen. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So this is a case study of two farmer producer companies based out of Nabrangpur. The value chain that I will be discussing is on maize. And we have two blocks. One is Umarkot and the other one is Raigar blocks. And we have two FPOs, Molima FPO and Pendrani FPO. Before I begin, I would just like to highlight the newspaper cutting from Business Standard, 26th of June 2021. So the two FPOs I'm talking about, they are currently very much well published by different media agencies because of the success, because of the remote locations and the way these two tribal FPOs are working in the field. So they are almost 2.5 years old, and the success story that I'm going to share. So you can see from the location, the right side corner, there is a map how to reach to the FPOs. So basically the nearest airport is 200 kilometer, that is Raipur. The other airport that is nearby is Bhubaneswar, which is 600 kilometers. Nearest railway station, Kesinga, or that is around 230 kilometers. And there are a lot of challenges in reaching out to this particular place. It is one of the remotest location in the tribal hinterlands of Odisha. And even many people do not don't like to go to such an interior and work in such an area. So this is one of the most difficult tribal territories which we are working. There are two FPOs I have seen, Umarkot and Raigar. Going to the next one. So I would like to straightway first share the report card of these two FPOs. Pendrani and Molima, PKPCL and MMPCL, as we are promoting them as a maize cluster. So some data would be as a combined data and some data would be the individual FPO-wise data. If you see the left side top corner graph, the cumulative performance of the two FPOs since last 2.5 years, almost it's two years and 9 months has already crossed since their establishment. The first year you can see the total turnover, cumulative turnover of the two FPOs is 41.76 lakhs, out of which 25.29 they have sold maize and 16.47 lakhs they have sold only agri inputs. So that was 2000, and this is the same case with most of the FPOs that are currently being promoted, and I have personally been associated with less than 120 FPOs since last 10 years. So I am also aware of the situation. So most of the FPOs, they struggle at a turnover at around 10 lakh, 20 lakh, 30 lakh, 40 lakh, 50 lakhs. So that seeing that challenge, this, well, you can see now what is the growth. I will discuss how we have achieved this one. So financial year 2020 and 21, the FPOs have closed at a cumulative turnover of 4 crore and 7 lakhs, out of which they have sold maize worth 2 crore and 97 lakhs and agri inputs 1 crore and 10 lakhs. And the current year 2021-22, you can see there is still the growth is continuing. From last year cumulative sale of agri inputs 1 crore and 10 lakhs, they have now gone 3 times. So they are now till 15th of December 2 crore and 96 lakhs they have achieved. Maize, if you see, last year it was 2 crore and 97 lakhs. This year the season has just begun. So this will currently it is 1.79 lakhs. And this is for the Rabi maize season. So the Kharif maize season is currently ongoing. So last year there was no Rabi maize sale. We are targeting something around 4 crore to 5 crore of maize sales in the current financial year. So if you see, overall the cumulative turnover has already crossed the last year cumulative turnover of both the FPCs. They are growing at a very sound pace. The right graph, if you see 2020-21, both the FPOs have cumulatively sold 22,000 quintals of maize, and as on date, they have already sold 11,664 quintals, and this is ongoing, and this figure would double from the last year. If you see the cumulative trade of the FPOs, so Pendrani FPO, which is in Umarkot, it's a very small block headquarters. So they, it has already achieved a turnover of 2 crore and 86 lakhs in the current year against the turnover of 2 crore and 32 lakhs in the previous years. Similarly, FPO in Raigar, which is the border district of Odisha with Chhattisgarh, that has already achieved a turnover of 1 crore and 88 lakhs against the total turnover of 1.77 crores in the previous year. If you see the total balance sheets, though the, both the FPOs are working in 50, around on an average 50 villages, around 18 GPs, membership is between 1400 to 1300. Around 30% are women members in that. They're actively participating. The paid up capital is on an average around 7 lakhs and 30,000 to 7 lakhs and 70,000, which is growing at a very fast pace. If you see the survival mode, so as I'm particularly sharing this, because most of the FPOs, as I said, they fight, they currently are struggling with a turnover of 10 lakh, 20 lakh, 30 lakhs. And same was the case for both the FPOs. So one FPO was at 29 lakhs and the other FPO was 12 lakhs and there was a negative balance sheet of 660 rupees for one of the FPOs. However, as you can see, I have already shared the data, so no need to go to the details. So net profit generated accumulated after all taxes. So the FPOs have paid 18% MAT. So after the taxes, the net profit is 2,61,000 and 2,17,000 for both the FPOs. One of the critical success factors is last year they have availed loan from NAB Kisan and Samunnati, cumulatively 20 lakhs and 25 lakhs, around 45 lakhs they had availed. And this year already they have availed, they are in the process of availing loan of 70 lakhs. So this is the balance sheet. Pictures say 1,000 words. So without saying much, I would say that these are some pictures from the field, how the FPOs are working. So basically, each and every truckload of maize, on an average, right now we are supplying daily one truckload of maize on an average. So each and every truckload that is being supplied, that actually the local community, the board of directors, the farmers, they actually send the truck after a flagging up so that there is much more publicity. On the left bottom, you will see our focus on quality management. Because of tribal areas and domination of lots of local traders, nobody was training the farmers or teaching the farmers on quality management. Farmers were selling their maize at 17%, 18%, and that's why moisture, and they were getting a lot of rejections out of that one. So we have run a campaign, a door-to-door campaign. We are promoting scientific maize quality practices door-to-door. We are training the farmers, and we are giving them a certificate of quality. Basis this certificate of quality, even local traders are now paying them higher premium. So you can see the FPOs are doing all the activities, including warehousing, then price discrimination discovery. So in Odisha, there is no price discovery mechanism except paddy. So we are calculating the prices of nearby markets like Raipur, Rajnandgaon, then Kolkata, various places in Odisha. And we are arriving at a spot price, and we are disseminating the price through price boards, loudspeaker campaigns, and like that. Both the FPOs are supplying agri inputs. The right side, you can see they are also running a custom hire center that is particularly for paddy harvesting. And the most important thing is implementation of technology. So they have now implemented barcode based traceability system. So say suppose one truckload of 420 bags, out of that, if a farmer one has supplied 20 bags, then we can trace at any given point of time. You scanning the barcode, we have developed our own mobile barcode application. What is the moisture? What was the fungus? What is the quality of the maize that is being procured? So this is about the pictures, and this is the growth story that how these FPOs have grown. So the highlighted ones.
You have about a minute, Shubhendu.
Yes, sir. Okay, so it was a difficult geography. There is no price discovery mechanism. Farmers are not aware of the quality. Transportation challenges, a lot of challenges were there. So in the first year, the FPOs entered into seed business and a little bit of maize marketing. Second year, the FPOs entered into, they identified around 15 plus buyers. We, with the support of the program team, got the distributorship of IFCO. The key challenge was payments to the farmers. So through the loan from Samunnati and NAB Kisan, we, using 45 lakhs of loan, the FPOs have rotated that amount and paid 256 lakhs in the farmer's bank account. That was one of the deciding factors. And this year, currently, this FPOs are actually being promoted as a hub of excellence within Odisha, not only in Odisha. 4 CVBOs, 21 FPOs, they have come for paid exposure visits. So within 2.5 years, these FPOs are now being visited by many of the FPOs and CVBOs in the, from the current 10,000 FPO scheme. They are currently selling more than 90 varieties of agri inputs. They have added chickpea, cowpea, green pea, paddy seeds. So they are currently diversifying. And the critical success factors, as I in the bottom, are the financing that we got, the quality aspects that we got, and the agreement with the buyers for supplying them in within timeline, and convergence with the state government schemes. So this is one of the critical success factors. We have got a lot of support and positive support from the state government. So all these are have resulted in the success of this FPOs. And this is the final one, sir, the last 1 minute. So this is the future plan of this FPO. So currently we are working on capturing the carbon trading market. So on an average, around 1500 to 2000 rupees each farmer can get who is capturing the soil carbon. We are promoting nano urea, which is recently launched. Farmers are facing a lot of challenges. So around 2200 acres of nano urea commercial application already being established. Nano DAP demonstration very successful with IPCO, and we are also pointing for precision agriculture using drones. So thank you, and
thank you, Subhendu. Thank you for this excellent presentation, giving us two examples from the field. Can we go off the slide now?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
So basically, Subhendu is telling us that there are some key determinants as to how a promoter looks at sustainability. It's about, say, the membership, the indirect outreach to the families in terms of services, maybe certain amount of equity being raised, also about turnover, becoming profitable, whether they are able to adopt long-term sustainable processes through IT so that the ease of operations is established, and of course access to loans, and more importantly, the ability to turn over loans multiple number of times. One of the key factors I saw was the loans taken, they have been turned over about 7 to 8 times in terms of payment that they made to farmers. Now I turn to the panel just to look at, in general, when you look at this large number of FPOs, which Subhendu Mayuk said in the beginning, we have got about 15,000 odd FPOs. Some of them have spent quite some time, right, on the ground. Do they look like commercial enterprises? So when we look at sustainability, what is it that we are looking for in that? Maybe I will talk with, start with Dr. Goel.
Sure, thank you. Thanks for having me on this panel. I'll start exactly with the question that you asked, right? When we think about sustainability of an FPO, what should we be thinking about? And from that perspective, what do most of the FPOs today look like? So, there are many things that one could think of, but I would put it in fairly simple ways. One is that we need the FPO to be financially viable, right? That's the first thing of any kind of a business enterprise. This requires many things. So for example, ability to run operations, be competitive, have a sense of the business, business acumen, going beyond writing a business plan and so on. The second category I would say is internal governance. Because for the organization itself to survive over a period of years, that becomes very important. And here I'm not talking about only regulatory compliance, huh? That's a small portion of it, but also having, clarity of roles, responsibilities, internal processes, how to set up, how to bring in operational efficiency and controls. But also because of the nature of this kind of FPOs, bringing in transparency with shareholders. And there is a very unique thing about shareholders in FPOs, which we all know, but I want to say it explicitly, that unlike in a corporate, or a joint stock companies, where a shareholder is separate from the operations of an organization, here shareholders play multiple roles, right? So they are suppliers and they are also the owners of the organization. And so when we think about governance, Here is particularly important to think about the shareholders in both those roles that they have. So what is that we want to do for with them, for them, with as suppliers, as well as shareholders of the organization. And the third category in terms of sustainability I would look at would be the, that's important, would be the business ecosystem. Now, no company succeeds on its own, you know, standing alone as an island in a vastness of nothing, right? So we need, organizations, which are institutions, which are providing financial services. Even, you know, if you think about companies that are started in urban areas, right, they have startup incubators, right? Where are those incubators? Now, we have a lot of capacity building training that is going on. But real incubators that many urban companies are able to take advantage of, they really don't exist beyond the trainings that are happening. Linkage with government programs, and even, you know, a stream of qualified talent, you know, people who can join these companies, right? So if today there are 16,000 companies, we need 16,000 CEOs. We need, you know, into 10, you know, number of board members. We need same number of perhaps at least one professional manager per company. And you can do the math, you know, somewhere between 2 to 3 lakh people just for the FPOs that already exist, right? So this entire ecosystem is missing. So I'll just summarize, you know, 3 points. One is the financial viability we have to think about. Second is the internal governance. And third is the ecosystem that supports any business enterprise. So now with this lens, if we think about what is happening with the FPOs today, so if there are 16,000 FPOs, and you know our study was looking at FPOs by the end of March, by now in December, I'm sure many, many more have started. And we see and hear about success stories of like we just heard, but these are few and far between. If you look at the majority of them, you know, very few that are able to reach minimum thresholds of capital, of loans, I mean, working capital, so that they can even start operations. I would say probably, regardless of which metric you look at, probably no more than a few hundred, you know, would really be, if you go there, look at it, it feels like an enterprise. Whether they are doing input side or output side doesn't really matter. And you know, you have many rules of thumbs that, you know, different organizations have put forth. For example, NABARD and NABKISAN talk about needing a minimum of 3 to 5 lakhs in paid up capital, maybe another 10 to 15 in debt. And if you go by these numbers, it's just few hundred companies. And they're the same companies that everybody invests in and everybody talks about. So that's where I would leave it. I mean, yeah, that's what the bulk of the companies look like, though it is always nice to see the success stories, small areas. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Govind. I'll come back to you on a second round with some of the things that you have raised and how it looks in the ground. I would now turn to Mr. Thorat. How does this FPO ecosystem look to you in general? You are sitting on the top of several of these FPCs. You know them in a manner that none of the others in the panel know. Do they look like enterprises that are in business and commerce? Some of the things Dr. Govil referred to just now in her opening remarks.
Yeah, thank you. So surely the aspect two panel members mentioned about, first one organizational structure and the second one associated with the business modeling. So we are talking about the social enterprises, and sustainability of the social enterprises depends on the two fundamental principles, which is I mentioned, firstly organization and secondly what business they are going to do. So accordingly, right now, if we are making the evaluation of different farmer producer companies, already one of the panel member had critically analyzed one of the farmer producer company. So that might be one of the case study. But whenever we are looking organizational structure, then it comes to the basic of the institution, that is shareholders. And again, shareholders means whom we are considering the shareholders, because in broader context we are talking about the farming community. So whenever we are talking about the farming community, they are again segregated into different course of actions. That means someone doing with crops, someone horticulture commodities, so different fisheries, then animal husbandry. So basically whenever we are talking about the farmers, then again different aspects are coming into the pictures which are closely associated with the value chain. So again when success of the organizations or the sustainability of the organizations we are mapping, then we need to map the value chain, and accordingly that value chain, what interventions this farmer producer companies had made into the systems. And again, if they are making some interventions or doing some innovations, then definitely last mile beneficiary, whom we are considering as an active shareholder, if it is getting benefit, and that benefit can be mapped again into different aspects. So economical parameter may be one of the aspects. Whatever social attachment associated with those economical parameter, and again, see, ultimately we are talking about the political economy of agriculture policy making. So in that context, socio-economical political aspect, if we are looking at beneficiaries lens, then I think sustainability can be mapped into that direction. Coming to the business modeling, so presently we are facing the problem of business modeling of the farmer producer organizations, because whenever we are talking about the FPOs, everyone is very keen and enthusiastic to deal with a lot of problems, and we are looking FPOs at one of the greatest solution to resolve all the problems. So I think that approach need to be changed, because these are the again business entities, again moreover social enterprises. So whenever social enterprises and business is coming into the picture, so value chain specific, commodity specific FPOs are coming, then I think sustainability is more, because this is completely arithmetic calculation. Because in case of the business modeling, we have to map their performance, business performance, and in context of the business performance, a lot of parameters are there. I think these two aspects need to be considered. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Turat. What you are saying loud and clear is one, sustainability may not be the size of profits as an FPO. We have to look at beneficiary sustainability and what the FPC managed to deliver to them. So it's a combined product of beneficiary comfort, their well-being, their improved livelihoods, and also the ability of the FPO to at least survive, if not what you call be very profitable. Because the nature of these are social enterprises. The second point you make is, this is not a cure-all, that it can do cancer to small cold, everything it will cure. No, for a given set of problems, if you structure it and if it's efficient, then we should look at sustainability from that angle, not about a whole lot of ambitious statements. I think the point's loud and clear. And now I turn to Mr. Bhatt. How does it look like to you? You have been financing early stage with no business plans to those which are reasonably evolved, come to the second stage, third stage. So do they look like business commercial enterprises, including what Mr. Thorat has said? Look, they are also social enterprises. You have to have a different lens.
Thank you, Srinivasan sir. I think with the introduction and motivating presentation by Subhendu and the inputs from Goyal and also from Thorat about the FPCs, I think what I would like to say is, as FWWB as an organization has been supporting the social causes. Yeah, in that way, in fact, if we see the history of FPOs, it was to address the issue of socio-economic development of the smallholder farmers. That is the, and there the focus was on the collectivation of the entire spectrum of activities. And we all know that it's a hybrid between cooperative and the corporate, wherein the corporate professionalism has to come working in the environment of the cooperative mechanism. So that we are very close to the last mile people. As Mr. Thorat was referring, we are working with the small people who are at the last mile. We need to make them understand that why we are here, why we should come do that activity. In that way, though it is a social goal. Yes, we are addressing the social goal, but what is the primary objective of that? In order to have the social good, you need to have some sort of arrangement to see that they earn some profit from out of their activities to make the organization sustainable. Now that we have understood that this institutional structure has been found, yes, this is one institutional structure, like a new animal called the farmer producer organization or farmer producer company, whatever we may call it, is a new organization which is in the news for say last 8 to 10 years, though the word was coined somewhere in 2002 or so, but actually we are seeing that activity from 2010-11 onwards or 11-12 onwards. When this structure has been built, as Mr. Shiv was telling and Sodhi was telling in the earlier in the morning about the, there has been a model now. Now you have a model which can be further improved upon to see that yes, the smallholder farmers are getting benefit out of this model which has been built and which has shown success. We have seen, see, over the years, as Richa was mentioning, about 15,000 to 16,000 FPOs have been registered. Maybe that after the announcement of the 10,000 FPOs, the number has doubled. Earlier it was about 8,000 number. In that way, if we see the success story of these FPOs, the success stories have been far and few. Yeah, but the thing is, these success stories definitely are role model for others to see that yes, from this institutional structure or this model, definitely successes can be derived if so many things are put in line. What are those things if we study? Because see, if we have seen the Fields of Change publication, I think it is yet to come out, but in that we see so many impactful stories from the field which has really helped. One is not only on the economic return side, but on the social good, social return which has happened to the tribal women in Madhya Pradesh or tribal women in Odisha or even tribal women in Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. No? These type of entities, if with proper support, have been able to do that. But having said that, what we have observed over the years dealing with, because FWWB is an organization which has been working with these FPOs since 2007. At that point of time, many of the people would not have known the name of the FPO or what is the FPO there. But what we have found over the years, I can, because success stories, definitely we can tell the, but what has been the missing points if we address that? One is these people or these organizations still treat them as a community entities, not as business entities. I think that entrepreneurial spirit is missing in FPCs which have either not able to come up or which are not able to, say, grow what is expected of it. Second one, we have talked about the sustainability. Sustainability definitely gets affected. As somebody mentioned earlier, that when the donor institutions stop their funding without ensuring that they avail the business viability, then immediately those organizations stop functioning or go defunct. Maybe that is the thing. The third thing is on the low capital base. Actually, if we see many of the organizations and if we see the Richa study also, the number of organizations having, say, more than 5 lakhs is very, very few. In that way, they are not able to see. If you have to do some business, you need to have some capital. Capital, one, own capital, equity capital, that may be difficult to get initial stages. But if you have some capital, whether you are able to leverage that capital to raise some debt and try to do some business. In that way, that is also the, because of the low capital base and they are not able to even leverage that capital to raise some money for doing the business activity. Unless you do the activity, you will not be able to get the economic return. That is how the thing is, this low capital is affecting their viability. Then what we found is the, because we were talking in all the speakers, what we have seen is the sense of ownership. Because if it is going as a imposed idea from the top, or somebody goes and says that yes, it is required, this organization required it for your, but unless it comes in their mind, yes, it is my, for our good, we need to do this activity, we need to start this institution. Like when Mr. Sodhi was mentioning that Tribhuwan Das Patel and Varghese Kurien, they felt that these organizations have to be there for our good and the good of, for the people. And people also understood that, yes, we are, once we build the organizations, we are able to get the benefit. In that way, that sense of ownership, I think we need to bring that sense of ownership before we advocate this idea of this organizational structure and the things, how it can run and make good to the people. Then what we have seen is the less number of active farmers. See, the term, suppose if you say that, okay, there are many members in the farmer producer organizations, but maybe about out of 500 members, hardly 10 or 15 members are active. How to make this members active, more number of, there are two sides for it. If number of more number of members become active, the FPC may not have capital to address their business needs. If no members are coming forward, then the FPC will not have business. It is a catch-22 situation for these organizations. That is the thing. And the proper business plan is also one thing, and a viable business model. Because when Subhendu was presenting, they have been, though they have been able to deal only in one commodity and some other supplementary commodity, they have been able to develop a business plan addressing the both backward and the forward linkages. In that way, they have been able to, therefore, a business proper business plan and viable business model is the necessity which I feel.
Yeah.
Then what we feel with these organizations is the understanding, lack of understanding on the value chain or the supply chain, and what are the critical elements of this structure that has to be really understood by these people.
Right.
One more thing is on the incubation and capacity building, because as I said earlier, this incubation and capacity building is an activity which has to run continuously for these organizations, and they need to, till they become viable, we should see that there are certain promoting institutions which are supporting even without the grant support. When such support goes, definitely they are able to do well, and they have to have that capacity building support and the handholding support continuously.
Yeah, we have a subsequent question on this. Actually, we are going to deal with the capacity building issue
in detail
slightly subsequently.
Yeah.
I think, Mr. Bhatt, meaning the way you say, there are quite a number of anecdotal cases that come out in different parts. But then the issue is also there are lots of them who do not seem to be financially strong to sustain. So being a social enterprise is a sufficient enough substitute for that. Maybe I'll now go to Yogesh, because he's still, I think, on the important meeting. So when he's still available, let me ask him this question. Given what we have so far discussed, if you take a particular FPO, how you would know that it has become sustainable? At what point you will consider it to be sustainable?
Good question. Basically, if we are looking the lens of sustainability through individual organization, so being MAHAIPC, we are dealing with 600 organizations in 28 district of Maharashtra. Out of them, 50% we are directly dealing with their business activity. So assume that 300 farmer producer company, we are doing transaction with them. So whenever we are going individual farmer producer company, so we map the sustainability based on various parameters. And let us say we are taking the example of whatever business activity we are doing. Already Mr. Bhatt mentioned about the entrepreneurship skills required for that organization. So whenever we are mapping or evaluating or analyzing individual farmer producer company, firstly, as I said in the first part, we are looking the organizational structure of that institution. Whenever any organization joining MAHAIPC for various business activities, we firstly ask them, what is your shareholder base? If they are saying that, yes, my shareholder base is 10 member farmers, then we are rejecting their proposal. We say that you make minimum 100 as your shareholders. So the basic criteria we are looking, that the institution should be bottom to top. So there should be a sufficient member base with them, and as per our various business parameters, we are looking 100 farmers is good number for doing the business with the farmer producer companies. Number two, then we look their governance. So number second question is how many board members are from the same families or blood relatives, and if that number is more than 60%, then again we ask them go to your organization and change your board of directors. So board of directors should not be homogeneous and from the same family only. So that is one of the aspect. And thirdly, whenever we are talking about organizational structure, the crux is professional management. Then we look after who is your CEO and who is your manager, who is going to operate on day-to-day basis with our professional management team. So looking after whether they appointed the CEO or not appointed the CEO. So accordingly, these are the key organizational human resource parameter we are looking after. Secondly, coming to the physical infrastructure part also. So what is basic physical infrastructure you have? If you are talking about value chain intervention, so do you have any farmer common facility center? Do you have small warehouses? Either it is owned or it is on a rental model. And thirdly, we are looking whatever financial management system you have. So in case of the financial management systems, because say, if any farmer producer company is coming, they are saying that we have huge number of farmers and they are talking in 100 and 1000. But when we are looking their actual balance sheet and active shareholders, that number is very minimal. Sometimes we look after their paid up capital, we look after their authorized capital, and then we are now directly straight going to their balance sheet. So please show your balance sheets, what is your turnover for the previous year and accordingly. So basically these are the parameters when we are looking after the organizational part. And number two aspect, as I said, in the business modeling, see, in cumulative aspect, MAHAIPC is dealing with member organizations in some common modalities and some common business parameters. So accordingly, we are giving opportunity to them. But again, individual aspect, whatever business models they have, whatever they are doing for the backward linkages, whatever they are doing for the forward market linkages, and whatever their turnovers, whether it is reflecting. Sometimes FPCs are saying that, yes, we are doing so much business. But when we are looking their turnover parameters, sales and purchases and books of accounting, so we are come to know that later on they are not directly dealing with, and cumulatively whatever they are talking, that is completely out of purview of the organizational structure. So basically these are two parameters we are looking for the sustainability of the organization.
So what you are saying is that it's just not financial. When you talk about sustainability, it's a comprehensive look at, are they geared to be sustainable? It's not that I make trading profit selling maize or potato or soybean in 1 year, but then am I geared to stably run this on a given business model in the interest of members? That's really fabulous. Mr. Bhatt, how does it resonate with what you do? So when you look at from your own roles that you have played in building institutions in the FPO space and also financing, some of these aspects that go into an assessment of sustainability, how do they look to you?
Yeah, when we see, as Mr. Thorat was mentioning, the sustainability aspect, I think one thing which drives the most is the diversifying income streams for the FPOs. That is one of the most important things for the sustainability of FPO. What we have seen in the FPOs, they do the input sales business and continue to do that. They are unemployed for most of the period. During the season only they do it. But how do we make them diversify their income stream? Having a multi-commodity or different, even if they're dealing in feeds, whether they can have cattle feed, different sort of fertilizers or biofertilizers or different type of things, they need to see that. And different communities are suggested. That is one thing which drives the most for making these organizations sustainable. Second thing is on the FPOs, these community collectives, no, or the FPOs, where the small farmers, what we try to make them is be little patient. Don't be in a hurry to make the organization profitable in the next year or the immediate year. No, we'll do this also, we'll do that also. Simultaneously, immediately, don't jump to so many areas, but build a strong building block, making the organization strong, understand the businesses well, understand the risks well, what are those things. Even if we start with, say, 5 lakhs of things in the first year, okay, you do 5 lakhs, understand the nuances of doing the business, how it is done. What are the pitfalls in that business? How we can develop that business? Suppose if we increase it to 5 lakhs to 50 lakhs or 5 lakhs to say 150 lakhs like that. How, what are the things we need to address? What are the risks we need to address? I think that is one of the things which it is there. The third thing is on the competency and commitment of the people. I think management also plays. Suppose if you see any of the organization, it is the professional management which drives the growth of the organization. The board, the other directors and other things, they will be given the supporting role and the strategic decisions. But it is the management which has to drive the business, which has to drive the community, which has to drive the staff to see that. I think there we are missing a lot. As Richa was mentioning that, yes, if we have 15,000 FPOs, we need 15,000 CEOs, 15,000 people and other things. In that way, that is one thing which is very much required. Okay. For that purpose, I think we have to take some guidance from the NRLM. The Government of India, for the NRLM program, they have put some national resource persons for some of the blocks and other things. In that way, why not we say that some experts are as resource persons, and these resource persons will be in charge of 3 or 4 FPOs, so that they would be guiding them as advisors and advising them from time to time how they can do the business. In that way, continuing on that is on the handholding support, because these organizations need, because even when they are during the donor support, either NABARD supported or SFAC supported or even other organizations supported organizations, no, they need to have continuous hand-holding. What we have seen in many of the cases is these organizations, when they go out, because when they are assisting, when the donors are assisting these FPOs, their people only will be managing the show. They will be giving all the guidance, and there is no, see, route for exit. Exit plan is not made properly without ensuring that exit plan, they leave out and they, these FPOs become. But we have examples wherein the organizations like ASA, Vritti and many other organizations have played that key role. Though the donor assistance is not coming, the advice like, see, on the accounting, then on the audit, then on the other areas of this one, the capacity building support have been given, continuously given by these organizations, lead organizations or the promoting organization, which will definitely make that organization accessible. Then there are certain organizations which are, one is run by the farmers themselves, wherever the board of directors are very active. And they are taken the role and they say that, okay, these three or three panchayats will be under my control. Like that, out of if 5 or 6 panchayats are there, each of the board of director will take control of 1 or 2 panchayats and try to drive the business there, motivate the people to come and there. In such cases where that leadership is there among the directors, that also drives to sustainability. They will find out what are the innovations that needs to be brought. They will understand the requirement of it. In that way, I think these are some 3-4 things which need to drive the sustainability of these organizations.
I think now I will put the question to Dr. Goyal. I'm also going to add an unfair element to this question, because I think we take liberties with academic researchers, scholars and all that. You have been watching this space now what, for 4-5 years, very closely studying in multiple rounds. In general, when you look at, there are definitions of what constitutes sustainability. The major point you made in your first round was there is a significant congruence of ownership interests and livelihood interests when it comes to being part of an FPC it is very unlike in ownership in any other company. A buyer of Maruti need not have a livelihood interest in the company. If the company prospers, he gets money. But an FPC, they have to give services to the member. So the congruence is there. And we have got now issues of what constitutes sustainable. Do you see from your macro point of view that there is increasing evidence that more FPOs are becoming sustainable? This is one. What do you see as the trend, if there is something visible there? The second part of the question is following up from what both Mr. Thorat and what Mr. Butt said. Who should be driving sustainability? The responsibility for an FPO to achieve sustainability, whatever way we define, should it be with the promoter, the government, or the FPO has a substantial part of this responsibility? What does this lie? Yeah.
Okay, so I'll go back to my definition of sustainability and what drives sustainability. So in terms of the core business aspects, you know, what I called simply financial viability, right? What we are seeing is that the companies which are older are able to raise more capital over time, but it's fairly slow pace, which is understandable because these are companies of small producers by and large, though there are many companies of larger producers also. And that just slows them down in terms of the pace, you know. So that is one area we're still seeing very few companies that are really able to overcome that. And if you can't overcome that, then the other two categories I mentioned of internal governance of the ecosystem, they almost become irrelevant, right? Because if the core is not functioning well. So I would say, though there is some evidence that with time they are able to improve capital, and the data also shows that. We'll be soon releasing that. But it's a slow pace, and it's true for a small number of companies, a percentage of companies. The other, you know, if I go deeper into that, you know, two, three points I would like to add. You know, one is that you know, designing the or discovering the business model itself, you know, takes time. And I think other speakers have also talked about it. You know, which commodities, you know, whether you want to go after B2C, B2B models, you want to, you know, trade in raw commodities or process them, you know, value. So all of these questions have to be figured out. And even the ones who have started a reasonable set of operations that feel like companies, they struggle with this. But this is natural, because any company would struggle with this, it will take some time. So I would not say that that's necessarily a deficiency, but it's a path that they are on. So we are seeing some evidence, but it's too little. I think, you know, for 16,000 companies, we should be seeing many more that become household names soon, but we are nowhere there, right? The other thing I want to comment on, one of the comments of the panelist was, you know, about multiple commodities and having some engagement throughout the year. And I think that's important for the reasons that were mentioned in terms of generating business, but it's also very important for maintaining the producer loyalty. Because the more number of transactions a producer has with the company, generally those companies are doing better. So, I mean, dairies, you know, started by, let's say, NDS, you know, you see that there. You see that in many other cases where the regularity of transactions improves, you know, the centrality of the company in the lives of the producers. I'll now come to the questions that you asked. In terms of the last question you asked, in terms of whose responsibility should it be? You know, if we go back to why did we start or have this policy on producer companies, it was with a very clear purpose, right? To improve the lives and livelihoods of small producers, right? I mean, that was the starting point. And if we judge it by that, I think it's a collective responsibility. It's not only the responsibility of the producers. Now, what we would like to see is that, say, over a period of 7-8 years of handholding, they are able to run the company by themselves, and they are able to hire the professionals they need. Right? That's where we would like them to go. But that's a far, you know, far cry from where we are. I mean, we have visited, and I'm sure everyone has seen companies of, you know, women producers in Adivasi areas or other parts of the country which are not so agriculturally developed. I mean, to expect them to be able to run a company, it's it's a very high bar to set. So certainly we will need to be, as the government, as civil society, need to be able to handhold these companies for actually a long time to come. Before you start seeing corporations, coming out of these spaces. And, we often use the example of Amul. But if you think about Amul, decades of investment went into Amul, right? It was not 3 years. And crores of money went into money Amul. Right? So to expect, the new Amul to come out of, Chindwara or wherever, it's just going to take a lot more.
Okay. That's a great way of putting it. The new Amul cannot just appear from thin air, so to say, and whatever monies we are committing, they're okay, but then more sustained work in non-money terms, what Mr. Bhatt talked about earlier, we'll come back to that. I think, incidentally, this was also based on the last part you answered was based on a question from Neeraj K. Lal. Thank you, Neeraj, for the question. I have another question which I will now direct to Mr. Thorat. There are two parts to this question. One is whether the state level federation is able to provide benefits to the shareholders, which are FPCs, or the state federation competes with the FPCs in the marketplace. This is one question. And second is, I think basically, do you have an exit policy when it comes to when you would like to withdraw from supporting, say, an FPC?
The question associated with the role of the state level producer company or federations. The genesis of particularly if I am speaking about Maha FPC, it was need-based genesis. So in 2014, whenever ecosystem of the farmer producer companies was building, so it was thought by the member farmer producer companies that yes, we are working at the village level or we are working at the cluster level. But when we are considering the economies of scale, then definitely we are not able to compete with the market because market is bigger in size and the market has its own dynamics. So accordingly, if we are working in a competitive federal arrangement, that means farmer producer companies working at the village level and state level producer company working at the state level. If that two-tier structure is coming into the picture, so we can have economies of scale, we will have bargaining power, and we will have collectivism of the collectives. So that was the basic idea for the formation of the Maha FPC. And again, in the context of the competition of the Maha FPC with its member organization, so while devising the role of Maha FPC, we had limited our role up to business facilitator of member farmer producer companies. And in the context of the business facilitator, we are not disturbing the ecosystem of village level farmer producer companies, because success of the federation of the or the success of the state level producer company depends on how much strength their baseline units or farmer producer companies have. So the success of the federation is the magnification of the success of the farmer producer company. So whatever we are talking about Maha FPC right now, so definitely its grassroots units are becoming stronger, and profit and in context of dividend to the member farmer producer companies. So right now we are dealing with 5 mandate commodities, that is pulses, oil seeds and perishable commodities like onion. So in that commodities right now we have very strong G2B business with the government, and what we did, we made a very robust procurement channel through PSS procurement operations, and we look toward the channel as a capacity building tool. So that is not our goal. So we are building the capacities of our member organizations by engaging them into direct commodity handling. So in the last 3 years, we handled around 1200 crore rupees commodities, and the funds has been beneficiary farmers are around 1.5 lakh and the volume of the commodity is 2 lakh metric ton. So see, this is the infancy stage business activity. When FPC is understood how to handle the commodities, how to manage the supply chain, how to submit commodity into the warehouses. So based on the experiences, apart from these mandate commodities or the common business models, they are independently dealing with different corporates. So I think that might be the exit strategy of the Mahapc. So some farmer producer companies are devising their own business models and they are directly linking themselves with the market players. But again, some farmer producer companies are demanding that why not again to compete with the corporates if we are coming into the private segment also. So we initiated our corporate trade division and now we are dealing with the corporates either in broker model or either in the trader model, so that we are, our role is restricted to the facilitator. And I think we had distributed dividend of around 5 crore rupees within last 3 years among our member organizations, yes, yes. And which are exclusively active members. So and this year our earning per share is around 2000. So wow. That is the huge jump in the profits. And as I said, coming to the picture of the sustainability, right now we have very robust value chain operations and last 3 years data points is there. So we are analyzing the data of member organizations. For example, in the last 3 years, yeah, we facilitated around 4,000 villages. So now we are more talking about making the system robust. So okay, accordingly, I think I may have answered your question.
Yeah, yeah, I think it meaning very clear that you are not competing, you are only facilitating, improving their ability to be more productive. At the same time, you are also saying you produce enough profit to be able to give a dividend to your member FPCs. Now we are turning to very rapid, what you call, answers. No answer can be more than a minute long because there are a few questions that are coming from the audience as well. This question was asked by Himanshu, which just now Mr. Thorat answered. Now the next question is asked by two people differently. I'll consolidate them. Subhendu, this is for you, a fairly short answer. How long you are going to be handholding the FPCs that you are having? Do you have some rough idea of a timeline till when you should do? And then when you actually exit from them, are they going to be able to continue on their own? So this question is from both Mr. Himanshu Agela and Dhananjay. Yeah.
So we believe business is the key driver, that is the engine. And that's how we are marching towards turnover and profit. And another 1 year, we are seeing that the FPO should be able to sustain on their own. Already they are meeting up around 80% of their expenses. So it's already in the path. 1 year, I believe they will be in the right track.
Thank you. Mr. Bhatt, again, a very quick answer. Introducing entrepreneurship is the biggest challenge when we work with FPOs, right? So how do you promote the strategies in the FPO to be able to take risks and then diversifying the business with the spirit of enterprise? We have a very fairly complex question, but right, I still require a simple, short answer.
Yeah, in fact, these FPOs, as we have told, that they need entrepreneurial capacity to develop the business. That can be best done by having, one is to the exposure visits, which are other successful businesses where they can go and see and understand from them that how it can be done. And to promote that, that's one thing. Second thing is deep and wider capacity building. See, the thing is, what the present capacity building initiatives are there, that it's a superficial. I think we scratch the surface and then, okay, we have conducted the capacity building activity and we don't go deep into the activities. In that way, that deeper capacity building and wider approach for this capacity building is really important to generate interest in those people to develop that entrepreneurship ability. I think these two things are very important. Then anyway, supply of capital is definitely important. That in that way, FWWB is doing that role of providing the initial capital, though they are not capable. Okay, you, we'll give you 5 lakhs, you start with that and show your entrepreneurial ability. We'll give you 50 lakhs later, 1 crore lakh, like that. In that way, supporting systems also work that entrepreneurial ability. I think I will stop because we told it short.
Yeah, it should be short, quickened. Yeah. Thank you so much, Mr. Bhatt. Dr. Govil, I will now turn to you. There is a question which is slightly general, but then there are quite a number of aspects which you referred to earlier. It says farmers are very good at doing farming. They do the hard labor. But then when they have to turn into an enterprise, what kind of ecosystem model will represent farming as a business enterprise? Is it aggregation, the way we are doing in FPCs?
If we look at the organizations, the FPOs, which have been successful to some extent, at varying extents, a large number of those are going beyond aggregation, right? And they are doing value addition. Now, it can be processing of different kinds, depending on the kind of produce that they are handling. So when we think about ecosystem, it's not limited to an ecosystem that is suitable just for the aggregation of produce. It has to, our imagination has to include storage facilities if they want to do delayed marketing or value addition of different kinds, you know, if it's fruits and vegetables, pulping, all kinds of different things that different FPOs are trying. So that is one side, huh, which is the business operations side. But the ecosystem also includes others. So for example, you know, institutions which provide financial services, this keeps coming up again and again, because if your own equity in the company is very limited, very few institutions, hardly any will be willing to lend any money, right? And certainly not banks. So it becomes, you know, very complex, but it's not limited to that. There is talent, right? We have to have people who can go and work in these organizations. There are also, you know, from ecosystem perspective, there are also policy aspects, right? So there is certain ways perhaps one can think about, should the policy allow, let's say, listing of FPCs on the social stock exchange that has now been approved, right, by the SEBI committee. So, or even the matching grant, should it in certain geographies, let's say aspirational districts, right, should the matching not be just one to one that is there in the current policy, but should it be 3:1? I mean, I'm not saying it must be, I'm just saying that we have to be a little bit more creative and make these kinds of distinctions and see what might be feasible to bring in also from a policy perspective. On the capacity building, yes, I agree, you know, the capacity building has been fairly limited. And, you know, it mixes up multiple things, at least that's what we have seen, right? So it mixes in extension, what is usually called extension services for production practices, quality management, and so on, business operations, and internal governance. And these are three very different things. And when we think about capacity building, these organizations need all of them. Right, so it's a quite a complex space, and we have to be more creative, I think, both from on the field as well as from a policy perspective, and also more comprehensive.
Yeah, I think this is a second unfair question put to you. Quite tough, complex. How we formulate a response to different individuals operating on their own, but we want them to be doing business and commerce. The impossibility of making shareholders out of people who did don't understand the investment form, but in their own it. And I think, I'll now turn to a question which, again, Mr. Thorat, since he is still continuing to be available to us, what would be, the list of priorities in terms of policy when it comes to improving sustainability of FPC? You can make it quite brief also. So what would be your top three priorities? The same question comes to all others as well. Yeah.
Yeah, in case of the policy advocacy, we expect a conducive environment for doing the business, number one. So we want a very clear-cut legal framework for handling agriculture, value chain, supply chain, and in broader context, conducive environment for agriculture marketing, either within state or interstate operations. Number two, in case of the fundraising, see, businesses cannot happen without the funds. So, yes, we have strong social capital through farmer producer companies, but we need to convert that social capital into the corporate finance or financial capital. So, in that context, the journey is not quite easy because we are not bankable. And as other players in the ecosystem are trying to create the ecosystem, that is not even sufficient whatever we are dreaming for the FPOs in the future. And thirdly, there is a need to have very concrete ecosystem stakeholders with role and responsibilities in place. So what the role government should play for next 5 or 10 years, what bankers should play, what forward market linkage players, for example, corporate players should do. If that role and responsibilities are fixed by the ecosystem through policy advocacy, then I think we can bring FPOs not only as a sustainable institution, but institutions for the change.
Well, thank you, Mr. Tharad. Shubhendu, very quickly, what is your list of three priorities?
Yeah, so I would give additional three lists. First is infrastructure. So wherever it has been seen that there is warehousing structure or there is cold store structure, good access to roads, this has helped the FPCs to grow. So this is very varying state to state, in various states, wherever it is available, FPCs have grown. Second one is financing. So financing, though FPOs are coming under finance, private sector financing, all the FPOs are struggling to get formal financing. Like we started, the example which I gave, started from Samunnati, then came to Nat Kisan, but we are struggling for loan from SBI. Similarly, and the third one is tax. Minister of Finance, under their circular, they have announced that FPOs are tax-free for 5 years, but they have not taken out they have not made any provision under MAT. So even though it is declared that FPOs are 100% tax-free for 5 years, FPOs have to file MAT 18% minimum. And so we cannot say that FPOs are not tax-free. So this is one of the key challenges that is being seen in the market. Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. Bhatt.
Yes, sir. One of the suggestions is to be, I think the policy has to be more inclusive in terms of geography and gender. The thing is, one state getting 40% share and among the 30 states is really too harsh. In that way, I think there should be some geographical this one, and gender also has to be receiving focus in the policy. Second thing is on the building on Richa's point about the capital. See, now government is proposing equity capital. I will go one step ahead in saying that why not you front load the equity like a back-end subsidy type of thing. You give them time, okay, over 5 years of time, you build this capacity. I am giving you 10 lakhs now. You build 10 lakhs over a period of 5 years. In that way, making them responsible or returnable. If you are not able to build that, you return the capital to the government. In that way, you will facilitate the business to them. Okay. The third thing is on the end. One more point there is, suppose when we see the actual performance, hardly 5% of the FPCs have been able to get the equity grant. That must be something wrong in the scheme itself to obtain that equity capital. In that way, there should be some relaxation in making available this grant to the FPCs. The third thing is on the guarantee scheme, because credit is very important. Again, guarantee scheme, SFAC guarantee scheme, though people say that it is one of the good schemes, but it is a cumbersome scheme and people are finding it very difficult to make it. And now the new guarantee scheme, which has come in the 10,000 FPOs also, there they speak of AAA rated companies. Which AAA rated company will finance the FPOs? That means guarantee is not available to organizations like, say, FWB or Ananya or even other organizations. Maybe Samunnati, maybe AA.
Samunnati, JKSON, anybody.
Yes, anybody for that. What is the use of that guarantee then? That guarantee should be made available to the institutions who are in the space of lending, who are practicing that thing. Then One more important thing is the effective insurance from the farmers, because unless we insulate farmers from the losses, we cannot continuously have their interest sustained in the enterprise. Because if there is a loss, though Fasal Bima Yojana is there, but in the first year it was really beneficial to the farmers, but subsequently the improvements over the years have lost interest in the farmers. In that way, I think a comprehensive insurance covering all the losses of the farmers, at least to the extent of input cost, has to be compensated to the farmers in the policy. I think that some 3 or 4 points which I would like to tell. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, Dr. Govind.
Sure. So I would say, 5 points here. One is inclusion and coverage, like Mr. Pat said that, a lot, if you look at the companies in the last 2 years, 38% of them have been registered in Maharashtra alone. And, if you think about where are the areas from, again, from the perspective of the policy's entire purpose, that we would want to support and promote these kinds of FPOs, there are in different geographies. So inclusion and coverage is certainly important, both geographical and social. Second, funding, everybody has talked about, and I also mentioned earlier, so I won't go into details of that. Similarly, capacity building, especially in terms of the business acumen, that is essential for any kind of entrepreneurship. Some of it may have to be hired, some of it would be developed locally. I also think, when we are looking at these kinds of companies, right, we often think about only the production side, right, and we often forget the market side. One could imagine, be more creative and imagine solutions, let's say, funding children of farmers, for example, to set up processing facilities. They need not be a part of the FPO. They may even be separate enterprises. So our thinking is sort of limited to one way of working, which I think we can expand and go beyond and see what else is possible. The other thing that I would add, which has not been discussed so far, is stronger shareholder protection. We think that that's very important because in our study, we have seen many cases where due to weak internal governance, and again, I'm not referring to compliance, I'm referring to governance of an enterprise. We saw cases where either due to limited capabilities or in one case, possibly something more than that, that the shareholders, I mean, the farmers, basically, whatever money they had put forward, was gone essentially, right? And so, how do we ensure that the people that we are trying to benefit through these companies are actually protected against those kinds of situations, whether inadvertent or malpractices? So I think from a policy perspective, that would be the fifth point that I would make that's absolutely critical. And so far, we haven't really done that.
I think it has been, fabulous set of priorities that have come through.
If I can add one more point.
Please.
Yeah, one is on the infusion of external capital. See, the thing is, now they are not able to take the external capital either by way of quasi equity or subordinated debt type of things. If there is an organization which would like to do some business, professional people are there, they are not able to raise the money. It is the people who have to give the money. People may not be able to. At that point of time, the interested donors or this one, they should be able to put some quasi equity type or the subordinated debt. That enabling policy environment would definitely help the system to improve much better.
Okay. I think that's a good addition. I think I'll try and wrap this around now that I'm getting some messages from the organizers as well. And there are a couple of very general questions from the audience. I'll deal with that first. One is, what is the difference between a PO and a self-help group? A self-help group is a much smaller grouping in the normal course, and it's more an affinity-based grouping where you save, then you also make loans to each other from the group's corpus, maybe try and borrow. It's a fairly well-established system. It does support livelihoods at the smallest possible level, but it is not found to be suitable even to support farming on any scale. Because even a very small plot of land requires an average loan, 4 times the size of an average SHG loan. And they have much lower compliance load, easier to set up, easier to get linked to your bank. FPCs are much more difficult. The whole plethora of issues that all the panelists discussed around the FPOs, you would have come to know that these require much more intent, much more organization, also a kind of statutory compliance with several aspects of how you work, and significant aspects of ownership. What do you call planning for business and sticking to that? They are all involved. So I would leave the answer at that. The second question is about on the current legal obligations an FPO has to follow to ensure sustainability at the nascent stage. I wish the question had come much earlier than now, because there is a whole lot that comes there. All I would say is an FPO can be set up only in compliance with the law. They do due diligence of who can be on the board and how much capital and all that. And from the day you register, you have to follow all the legal requirements. You are subject to submitting returns and then complying with the company law provision relating to issue of share certificates and all, annual audit of accounts, maintenance, all that. So sustainability may suffer in the initial stages because of compliance, because some compliance costs are fixed costs. So how rapidly you scale up business will then determine how fast you could actually become sustainable, including all these costs. I will not go much longer into that. I think too, I should thank at this stage the fellow panelists for coming out with such rich insights and bringing out the number of variants and the contra that are available when we look at FPOs and their sustainability. They can be seen as social enterprises, like Mr. Thorat started with, because they are a community of people. And Dr. Yes, but then their economic interest as owner and their livelihood interest as individual people who are seeking to earn an income, they are totally intertwined, and you cannot get away from that. If you want a good FPO, you have to get good members who are willing to do good business with the FPO. The three goods actually get together, otherwise you don't get a sustainable FPO. I think in all, what it looks like is, yes, the assessment factors, which I think Maha FPO listed out through Mr. Thorat, I think they all remain relevant with all the additions made. You have to get a good member, say, a good amount of equity, a good outreach to members in terms of services, not just share capital, and you should have a business model. And the business model is such that it is not looking at trading profits, it is looking at making the numbers for a long time. Overall, you don't try and maximize profits over the short term, like Mr. said. You look at long term, whether you can run your operations well. That is a function of how much your members value you as an FPC, but how much the FPC values its members. Because there are trading FPCs which do business, which produce profits. There is no member connect except for the equity, meaning they are not the kind of institution one is looking at in this space. The new Amul is a very good example given by Dr. Govind. So when Amul became a household name today, a lot of Operation Flood monies went into that in the initial stages. And that money was used well, because there are lots of other projects where money went in. Not all of them became Amul. When can we use a bit of good money, some more, but very sensibly, like the way the Amul did and GCMMF subsequently did, and supporting organizations like NDDB, creating the knowledge base, the infrastructure, the marketing cloud. So can we see that in this space when we go from maybe 3,000 institutions 2.5 years back to now 15,000, we don't know where we will reach. But then this kind of size does require more higher level organization. So the policy level ecosystem that people have prioritized, maybe talk about this. The geographical inclusion, gender inclusion, and looking at what are the other viable businesses where government can make FPCs a part of what they do, the way they do in MP, maybe now in Telangana. Can they be part of procurement system, input sales? And there is also a huge movement now of that FPCs being community organizations in a sense, how they can be used to battle climate-related issues, to bring sustainable agricultural concepts in, and making farmers look more closely at the soils. I think there was a reference to carbon credit somewhere when we talked about, I think Subhendu did that earlier. So take into account those existential issues which talk about food safety, food security, nutrition quality, and ensuring that as farmers, when we interact with consumers, try and do in whatever way to reach them directly, we are conscious of their requirements as well. I think right at the end, what I would like to only say is this. Sustainability of FPOs is not a policy choice or option, look whether they will become sustainable. I think there is serious money that farmers invest in an idea that several people like us, whether government, whether banks, researchers, scholars, we brought into them. Look, if you become one institution like this, put some money of yours in, we could actually make it work for you in a much larger sense. The aggregation becoming a factor in making you a larger entity that can interact with the market, which has so far neglected you. So when you made this implicit promise, we have to see how they will become sustainable rather than whether they will become sustainable. Failure of FPOs, I would say from this point of view, is not an option. Cooperative, we have done enough. So let us ensure all those who are involved in this, whether it's policy, strategy, institutions that support the ecosystem, people, financier, and those who provide capacity building and incubation services. Let's have one objective. If this doesn't work, what will work to make this FPO sustainable? Because we are not giving up saying, oh, these are not going, these are D class. So failure, I would say, is not an option for FPO. We are going to ensure that they all become sustainable. And we have to only find what is the best way in a given local context they will become. I think I will leave it here. Once again, let me thank all the panelists for their excellent and rich insight sharing. And Subhendu, thank you for an excellent introductory case study for us. Over to you, Mayu.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, speakers.
Thank you, Srinivasan, sir.
We think this was an excellent and exciting discussion today. And the fact that we had a flood of questions coming in from the audience, I think, is testimony to the fact of how exciting this discussion was. The conversation was really grounded in real life examples from the ground, but also of some in-depth research looking at those examples from the ground. Thank you for panelists for the contributions. We talked about a wide array of priorities for supporting this cause of sustainability, but then we also talked about a very important issue about how after beyond a certain point, you really cannot rush the matter of making FPO sustainable. It is a process that will take time, that will take a lot of inputs beyond just finances, but also in terms of capacity building and in terms of creating an ecosystem, a conducive and supporting ecosystem. So thank you to the panel once again. Thank you, Richa Gobil. Thank you, Yogesh Thorat. Thank you, S.S. Bhatt. And thank you, Shubhendu Dash. And a round of special thanks to you, Srinivasan sir, for so deftly steering the conversation today and helping bring forth all examples from the ground. Before we end the session, I will just like to take the opportunity to once again thank all the delegates who have logged in for this session. We will have a short break of 10 minutes and we'll be back with the next session at 4:05 p.m. in the same hall. Please stay tuned and join us for the session on Invisible Farmers, Women in Agriculture. Thank you once again, everyone.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all.